Number 248. Number 248 in the church hymnal. Just over in the glory land.
Receptive tonight, dear Lord.
Yes, yes.
And you'll do a work tonight, dear Lord. We'll give you all the praise and honor in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Let's see. July the 26th, Sunday at 6, we'll have Adam Ragsdale, missionary to Thailand. He'll be with us. Hope you can plan on being here. In special prayer, remember Wendell McCormick, Pam Boggs, Lynn McMahon, Martin Schrader, Lee Riddle, Karen Brown, Jerry Bryan. Continue to pray for all our senior saints who are not able to be with us for the next few weeks. Any other announcement we need to make at this time?
Mom has cataract surgery again tomorrow, so we're
going to pray. Okay. Anything else? All right, then, if you would, turn to number 64. Number 64. Number 64. Number 64.
64.
Amen.
Thank you. Well, it's good to be seeing everybody here, having people back. Lord, we pray that the Lord shows up. I hope that you took out time today and asked him to come on into the church service. Y'all continue to pray for Brother Tim as he's down there with his daughter, Miss Tara, down there around ABAC, trying to figure out how they're going to make that work. One of the problems that, y'all do pray about this, one of the problems that they have is they cut the dormitory rooms down to one per room, which means every other kid don't have nowhere to stay. And so now they also scrambling, not even for the money to come up with for school, but a place where they can stay. And so y'all pray. Pray that either God will open the door or shut it. That's just that way they're in the center of God's will, and they're doing exactly what God wants them to do. But they went to church this morning to also, if she gets to go, to try to find out where she can attend church. And so he texted me and said they had a good time at the church today. But to continue praying for Miss Hannah, as her shoulder was all ripped up by the spur that was on her arm, on her shoulder, and that it would heal quickly. She was in a lot of pain. Some doing some better, but you know, it's going to take some time to rehab. Be praying for her. Be praying for Brother Wendell. Continue that the Lord will touch him, help him to that not the ringing. He says it's a rattle and popping in his ear, y'all, and it's really bothering him. He's also had two rounds of radiation. He's got eight more. Y'all be praying for him. Be praying for the two ladies, Miss Charlotte and Miss Pam, that's going to be having their last cataract surgery is tomorrow, and so be praying that it goes as good as it did the first time. Anything else we need special prayer over tonight? All right. I need two of our men to come down here, and we'll take up our evening offering. Has not God been good to you?
Amen.
Amen. And pray for the saw to go down across the river. Brother Jeff, go ahead and pray.
Dear Lord, Jesus, Father God, thank you for bringing us back to the house of the Lord.
Yes.
Pray the saw goes down across the river, Lord. Amen. Pray for our service. Be with Brother Tim and Isaac. Bring the message to us, Lord. Walk among us, God.
Please.
Bless us all.
Touch him.
Bless everybody that's here. And pray for everybody who can't be here.
Amen. Thank you. Started the message. Anybody got anything they want to brag on the Lord about? I thought, Brother Aiden, you wanted to. Go ahead and stand up and say it.
Thank God for saving me. February either 10th or 11th. I can't remember the exact day. It was either Friday or Saturday. And it was 2017. And I just remember laying on my bed, just right there on the edge of the bed. And my friend Caleb had looked up at me. He was spending the night at the time. And he looked up at me, and we had talked about it before, you know, we had had a moment of prayer where I didn't pray, but he did. And I thought I was saved, but I wasn't. And at that moment, he already knew I wasn't saved. And after that, he said, I think you need to be saved. You know, I knew I wasn't saved. And for a while before that, actually, I knew. Because I'd been going to New Salem Baptist Church, and I'd heard the preaching and everything, and I thought, you know, people saying, you need to ask God to save you. You need to know that you need a Savior, and you yeah. know that you have sin and you need to
yeah.
ask God to save you. And I'd never done that. And I knew I'd never done that. And that was the first time in my entire life that I'd asked him to save me. And I know, based on his word, that I'm saved by that. No matter what comes up in my mind, no matter what comes in my heart, my wicked heart, of what the devil tries to say against me, I know I'm saved based on that.
Amen.
I thank God for it.
Amen. All right. Amen. That's good. God's not done with us yet. Amen. All right, going on this morning, don't turn to it because we'll be back in Genesis. But we was at Romans chapter 12, verse 1. I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, wholly acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. It's presenting ourselves to the Lord. We preached on this morning, giving God yourself. Giving God yourself. And a lot of times we just think we're coming to church. Thank you. We're here to serve God tonight. Love on Him. Yeah. Give Him ourselves.
Yeah.
He deserves more of us every day. And He should get more of us every day. And yet we wonder why life comes up so empty sometimes. Why church is so empty sometimes, and we tend to worry about ourselves more than we do Him. And so I want to finish this up tonight, what we started on this morning, is giving ourselves to God. But then I want to look at it another way, because so many times, Brother Chuck, we kind of think we're giving our all, and we think we're doing a pretty good job. But then when you see it in light of what people's done from the Word of God.
Hello.
Or if you ever read the book on Fox's book, the Martyrs. Yeah. Fox's Book of Martyrs, where you watch people, I mean, you read how people die on the stake singing Amazing Grace as they're being burned. And praising Him and thanking Him. Would I do that? Has He got enough of me that when something like that happens, when something like heart attacks happen or cancer happens, does He have enough of me that I'm going to hang in there when hell is raging in my life? When you get wore out and tired of this journey and it seems like you got no friends and nobody cares and everybody's against you and turned their back on, does God have enough of me that I'm still going to have the right spirit within me?
Yeah.
I'm still going to have the right attitude.
Well, preacher.
To where He gets the glory out of my life and not me. Or when things seems to go right, you preach a message or you teach a Sunday school or you sing a beautiful song and God falls and God uses it and people get help and people get strengthened and encouraged, that He's got enough of me that I don't rise up with pride and go, boy, I did it. I did a great job. Does God have enough of us to where we please Him in our daily walk? I want to go over some people tonight, and then I want you to, I wish you would think about it, that as we're going over it, what would I do in that place? Genesis chapter 37, we'll start there. Genesis chapter 37, young people, I really wish that you would pay more attention because you're still at that pliable age.
Yep.
I really believe that God has given us some young people in this church that would like to have more God and God to have more them.
Amen.
I really believe that.
Yeah.
I'm not saying all our young people do, but I do know that some, by their attitudes, by how they, what they do and what they say and how they always seem to do something for the Lord, that they're wanting God to have more. And I really wish that you would listen for y'all older folks that maybe you started out late in life and you're learning how to give God more. I wish that you would listen in close to what we're fixing to say tonight, what the Bible's fixing to bring out. What would you do? Would you still give your life to God? In Genesis chapter 37, verse 1, it said, "These are the generations of Jacob, Joseph being 17. Now, hopefully, young people, how old are you, Aiden? 17. Your age. "And Joseph, being 17 years old, was feeding the flock with his brethren. And the lad was with the sons of Bilhah and with the sons of Zilpah, his father's wives. And Joseph brought unto his father their evil report." Now Israel loved Joseph more than all his children. Now I want you to know that Israel and Jacob is the same two people. You remember his name was Jacob, meaning liar, trickster, deceiver. Israel, God changed his name the night that he wrestled with the Lord. And so now Israel loved Joseph more than all his children because he was the son of his old age and he made him a coat of many colors. So I want you to notice that Joseph is just 17 when the Lord started dealing with him. Just 17. Verse 5. "And Joseph dreamed a dream." Now this dream comes straight from the Lord. case you didn't get it, that's Genesis 37. He dreamed a dream, and the Lord sent this dream, and he told it his brethren. I'm going to tell you what the Lord gave me last night in a dream. And so he told them, and it says, "For behold, we were binding sheaves in the field, and lo, my sheaf arose and stood upright. And behold, your sheaves stood round about and made obeisance." In other words, they bowed down to my sheaf. Boy, that made them mad. So God, it give him a dream and letting him know what he's going to want for his life. And in verse 9, "And Joseph dreamed yet another dream and told it to his brethren and said, Behold, I've dreamed a dream more. And behold, the sun and the moon and the 11 stars have made obeisance to me." And he told it to his father and to his brethren, and his father rebuked him and said unto him, "What is this dream that thou hast dreamed? Shall I and thy mother and thy brethren indeed come and bow down ourselves to thee in this earth?" So here's the thing. God's got a plan for Joseph. That's what he's letting him know. "Joseph, I got a plan for you, and here it is. You're going to be a ruler somewhere. You're going to be somebody with high position. And you're going to be so high that even your mother and your father and your brother are going to come bow down to you." Well, now here's the Lord talking with a young boy at 17 years age of what God wants him to do and to be. Man, that'd be exciting, right? Ain't that what we want, is for God to talk to us and to let us know the plan that he has for our lives, yeah, and where, how we're supposed to go and do what will be pleasing to the Father, right, Brother Chuck? I mean, that's what we all want, I hope. Lord, to have more of me, and what do you want out of me, and what do you want me to do, and what's my life going to be, and how am I going to please you? And so even the father and the brothers knew what he was talking about. Boy, and the father, the daddy rebuked him and said, "There ain't no way, son, that I bow down to the son. The son bows down to the father, and that ain't going to happen." But can I tell you, God had a plan for Joseph. He's also got a plan for you.
Amen.
And it's supposed to be our job to want to fulfill it the best way we can. And so the first thought is, I don't know my plan. That's all right. God's big enough to let you know.
Right.
Just get your heart in a position that you will, that God will, can tell you. Get your ears in a position to get your ears to hear what God wants you to know about what he wants you to do. And trust me, there's a job that he wants you to do that only you can do it. I don't know the plan God has for you. You might not know, but God does know. Get your place. But let's go into this then. This is what I want to say. What are you going to do? You find out God's plan. You put yourself in a position, Lord, here I am, send me. I want you to use me. Here I am to be used. But Lord, you got to tell me. And so he tells him. But then I want you to look and see what you would do. Would you still give yourself to God and his plan if this happens? In verse 8, the Bible said, and as they get mad. In verse 20, his brethren, his own brothers, decide together as a pack, we're going to kill Joseph.
Yeah.
Would you still want to give yourself to God? Doing what God wants you to do, and knowing that your own family, your own brethren in the church, your own church family might hate you. In verse 8, it says they hated him. Hate. Hate brings about death every single time. That's why verse 20 is there. Verse 24, they decide not to kill him, but to throw him down in a pit. Would you still give yourself to God? That here is your life, just going to, seems like it's going to pot. Nothing's working. Everybody's talking against me. Nobody likes me. They throw me in a pit. And then they decide to bring him out, verse 28, and sell him off into slavery.
Yeah.
get rid of him totally out of our lives? Would you still have a good attitude toward what God wants with your life? Would you still do good for God, being sold into slavery and sold in the pit, hearing your brothers discuss about killing you? Would you still do it? What if giving yourself to God and His plans causes you to be sold again, even further away from home, now to the Egyptians?
Yeah.
So now your family's got no hope of finding you. Let's say your brothers decided, Brother Chuck, oh man, we messed up. Let's go find that Midian clan, Midianites, and we'll go get him back. You know, you hope. But no, now the Midianites done sold you off to Egypt. So now your brothers ain't got a clue where you're at. They don't know how to find you if they even started. There goes all hope of being brought back into the family. It's gone. Now you're a slave to the Egyptians, a type of the world. You're slaved into it. In verse 6, would you still have a good attitude? Would you still be in the right place, in the right position of your heart, that God could bless you? Let me show you the verse 6 here. Verse chapter 38. Well, sorry. Verse 39. And he left all that he had in Joseph's hand, and he knew not aught he had save the bread which he did eat. And Joseph was a goodly person, well favored. Look at verse 2. And the Lord was with Joseph, and he prosperous, and he was a prosperous man. He was in the house of the master's, in the master, the Egyptian. Look at verse 5. And it came to pass from the time that he had made him oversee over his house and all that he had, that the Lord blessed the Egyptian's house for Joseph's sake, and the blessing of the Lord was upon all that he had in the house and in the field.
Yeah.
Because of Joseph keeping his attitude right, not getting mad at God, I'm not taking it out on the Lord. Look at all the bad stuff happening to me. I've done everything you wanted me to do. I didn't ask for that dream. You gave me your plan. And look at all the things that's going sour in my life. He didn't do that. He still kept his heart right. The Bible said in verse 4 that he's still doing good. And he's still giving the Lord all the glory. So the Lord is still blessing him. Let me ask you a question. God's got a plan for you. God wants you to do something for Him.
Yeah.
We've decided that we'd give our all to God. But what if the plan seems to be going sour? Are you still going to hang in when everything's going wrong in your life? Is it still God's life to do anything He wants to do? Or if it's going good, it's His. But if it's going bad, then I'm going to take a hold and try to fix it. What would you do if you was Joseph? I know what I would want to do. What would you do if giving of yourself causes someone to try to tempt you, and then when you stay godly, they lie on you and say it's all you that's evil? That happened to Joseph. In 39 verse 7 through 12, the master's wife saw that he was a goodly boy and decided she wanted him for himself. And instead of giving in to sin, he took off running out the door when she grabbed his coat. And so his coat was left behind and he went running out the door. And then she come, and then the master come home. And then she played it all out like he come in done to her. And she screamed and yelled. And then so he took off scared and run out the door. And here's my proof. I got his coat. And so the master then gets mad and throws him in jail for doing the right thing. Does God have your life enough that if all things seem to be going bad,
come on,
you're sitting in the jailhouse you will still hang in there with the Lord?
Yeah. Come on.
You say that don't happen. Oh, we get mad and quit on God because we just don't feel good.
Come on.
Let that smooth on. Would you still do right for God? Well, verse 22 says in chapter, in the third chapter of 29 and 39 says this, and the keeper of the prison committed to Joseph all the prisoners that were in prison, and whatsoever they did there, he was the doer of it. He still stayed faithful. He still hung in there. He still done what's right. He still followed the Lord. Would you still trust your life to the Lord? Lord still blessed him in all that he did in verse 21 and verse 23. Would you still brag on the Lord sitting in prison?
Come on.
Let me show you. Chapter 40, verse 5 through 8. There was two others that was thrown in jail. And both of them had a dream, and they dreamed a dream, both of them, each man his dream, in one night. Each man according to the interpretation of his dream, the butler and the baker of the king of Egypt, which were bound in the prison. And Joseph came in and looked, and came in unto them in the morning and looked upon them, and behold, they were sad. And he asked Pharaoh's officers that were with him in the ward of the Lord's house, saying, wherefore look ye so sadly today? And they said unto him, we have dreamed a dream, and there is no interpreter of it. And Joseph said unto them, do not interpretations belong to God? Tell me them, I pray you. He's still saying, God knows all. It's still about God.
Yes.
Could you be lied on, thrown in jail, sold by your own brother, your family, talked about like a dog, almost killed, sold into slavery, sit there in a jail cell and say, God's got a plan for me, and God's still good, and God can do what you need today? Can you still do that? Has God got enough of you that he can? You'd still do that? Then I want you to, let's go on further. What would you do? Finally, in chapter 41, 14 and 15, there's something going a little right in Joseph's life. Before this time, since he's been 17 years old, there hasn't nothing been going good. Ever since God gave him that dream, ever since God gave him a plan for his life, everything has fallen apart. Everything has went down. He went down into a pit. He went down into prison. He went down. He just kept his life, just kept going down. And finally, a little glimmer of hope comes up in his life. And it says this in 41, 14 and 15. And Pharaoh sent and called Joseph, and they brought him hastily out of the dungeon, and he shaved himself, changed his raiment, and came in unto Pharaoh. Can I just do a little preaching spot right here and run this rabbit down? If you'll clean yourself up to go see Pharaoh, you ought to clean yourself up to come see God.
Amen.
If you'll change your garments to go see a president of the United States, or if you change your clothes to go see your girlfriend, you ought to dress up when you're coming to the house of God.
Amen.
You ought to look like you're going to meet God. Amen.
Amen. Now,
I shot the rabbit. Let's move on. He changed his raiment, came into Pharaoh, and Pharaoh said unto Joseph, I have dreamed a dream, and there is none that can interpret it, and I have heard say of thee that thou can understand a dream to interpret it. Now, does God have enough of you that something don't swell up inside of you and say, well, there's been enough bad happened to me. Finally, somebody's bragging on me. And you finally go,
yes, I can.
I can do it. Just tell me. Does God have enough inside of you that when you're being blessed or you're starting to be bragged on, that you will still get out of the front seat of your car, jump in the back, shut the doors and say, only God can drive this car.
Amen.
He said this. And Joseph answered Pharaoh saying, it is not in me. I'm not that man. There's nothing good about me. My heart is deceitfully wicked, and who can know it? Man, I'm telling you, but I do know one that can. God shall give Pharaoh an answer of peace. Can I tell you, when you ever learn that God's got enough of you and you done realized you enough of failure, that all you do when somebody brags, you can just go, man, thank God, praise God, he's worth it all. He's the only one that can do it. Also, then want you to look in verse 25. He just keeps bragging on the Lord. And Joseph said unto Pharaoh, the dream of Pharaoh is one. God hath showed Pharaoh what he is about to do. Verse 28. This is the thing which I have spoken unto Pharaoh. What God is about to do, he showeth unto Pharaoh. Verse 32. And for that the dream was doubled unto Pharaoh twice, it is because the thing is established by God, and God will shortly bring it to pass. I'm telling you, if they're ever in a spot where you might have a place for pride to kick in, you need to kick your feet out from underneath you and say, it's God that's done it all.
Amen.
It's God that's supplied the grace. It's God that's gave me mercy. It's God who's forgiven me of my sin. It's God who's given me the hope. It's God who gave me the mouth to preach. It's God that gave me the reason I can read the Bible. It's God that gave me the mind that I might be able to understand a little bit. It's the Holy Spirit inside of me that teaches me of the Word of God. It's God, it's God, it's God. And that way you kick yourself out.
Amen.
Does God have enough inside of you when finally you get to come out of the prisons of life? And boy, you get to maybe get to be on the glory seat, that you'll still take the back seat.
Amen.
As God, what would you do? Aiden, at 17 years old, what would you do? Man, I'd want to quit at times. Finally. Look at verse, in chapter 41, look at verse 46. And Joseph was 30 years old when he stood before Pharaoh, the king of Egypt. Now, how old was he when he got started?
17.
Brother Aiden, not trying to pick on you, but we used you tonight. You're 17. Joseph was 17. How would you like your life for the next 13 years to wind up so bad that the church won't have nothing to do with you? The brethren won't have nothing to do with you. You ain't seen your mom and daddy in years. You're sitting in a jail cell in prison, rotting away for something you did not do. You was lied on. Would you still hang in there with God? Does God still have enough that you can trust him and say, here it is, God, take it. See what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Have we really given God our life? Have we really given God our life? Let's move on to somebody else. I want you to look in 1 Samuel chapter 16. Studied on him. Wow, I done went all the way to Ezekiel. I believe that was a little too far. David is on the backside of the wilderness with the sheep of God, desert, whatever you want to say. He's watching over his daddy's sheep. The Bible does not say how old he is. It just calls him a youth, and it calls him a lad. So I looked up, and by some other men that are smarter than me, what they did was work backwards from the time that he was 30 when he took over king, and so they started backing up, and they says, nobody can come up with a date, but they say it's somewhere, he's somewhere between 10 and 15. We got anybody here that's 15? 15. How'd you like God to anoint you king over a kingdom at age 15? And you don't even know you are. You're about there keeping sheep. You're just doing what the daddy asked you to do, trying to be faithful for what you've been asked to do. So you're out there, and all of a sudden, there's a servant comes running out there and says, man, Samuel's at your daddy's house, and they're calling for you. And some reason, he stood in front of each one of your brothers. I was just trying to watch through the door. I don't understand it, David. But I'm going to stand here and watch over the sheep. You go back and figure out what your daddy wants of you. And so he goes back and he walks in the door. There's Samuel. He hasn't, won't even sit down. He hasn't even been fed yet. He's not going to even sit down and eat till he sees you. And you're a 15-year-old and you walk in. And this is not just any preacher. This is the preacher of preachers.
Amen.
This is the main man of God at this particular time period in this history. And so, boy, you walk in, you're scared to death, and he's eyeing you. And all of a sudden, you don't know nothing that's going on, and you're scared to death, and you stand in front of him, and he checks you out. Man, I would have freaked me out. And all of a sudden, he gets out his anointing oil out of that little horn. Yeah. And goes, you're it. Pours it on. Man, you're freaking out. What is all this about? You're going to be the next king of Israel. What? God had a plan for David.
Amen.
You say, surely this plan's going to go good. Oh, no. No, no, no. He sits, goes back out there to the sheep. Next thing you know, he's called to go to the palace. You think, this is it. I'm going to be king. He goes there, and the king that's already on the throne is King Saul. He's done wicked, went against God. God done rejected him, pulled his hand off from him. He's going mad, and they want somebody to play the harp for him, to calm him down when the evil spirits come on him. So you get up there, and you start playing your harp, however you play a harp. And all of a sudden, he calms down. And then you get to go back to the house. And every time that happens, you're called to come into the palace to play. God's just getting him ready to be in the palace, playing a harp. And then all of a sudden, he goes, sees one of his brothers. They're out in the war, and he kills a giant. So it looks like, man, he's good. People start singing about you like you're some kind of special person. You kill 10,000. Saul only kills 1,000. The next thing, the very next thing in your life, you're running for your life.
Yeah.
Saul takes a javelin while you're over there. He done knows you got a touch of God, probably to take his spot. So he takes a javelin and throws it at you. And you're ducking and running. God, you've anointed me to be king, and I'm running from my life, from the old king. Are you still going to stick in with God? He's got enough of life, got enough of your life, that you still say, God, it's your life. Do what you want. Can I tell you? The next thing he does is David's now a little older, and Saul tries to kill him by marrying him off to Michal, his daughter. All you got to do is get 100 foreskins of the Philistines, and you can have her. Thought that he would be killed in doing so. Then he goes back in front of Saul and plays again, and Saul does the same thing. And for the next 8 to 10 years, and here you've been, got a plan from God, been given to you from the main man of God, and you're running for your life the next 8 to 10 years, living in caves, living in wildernesses, living in the forest. Yeah. And every time Saul would get close and about captured, he would run again and hide again like he was just a low-down, no-good, dirty, thieving dog. For 4 years he lived like that. And to get away from it, he finally went to his enemy's camp and asked, could he live there? So he lived there in Ziklag for the next 4 or 5 years Would you still give your life to God when everything around you is going that bad? Have you given your life to God like that, to no matter what happens, God, it's your life. If you want to kill me, kill me. Y'all know in John chapter 11, the story of Lazarus. Jesus is sitting over there with his 12 disciples, his 12 apostles. And man, he's just sitting there just enjoying life. And all of a sudden the servant runs up and says, your friend Lazarus is sick. Won't you go heal him? Let's go heal him. Let me give you what the Bible says on that, because maybe it'll help you. Lazarus is sick, and he's fixing to die. Heart problems, cancers, liver problems, kidney problems, coronavirus. Does God have enough of your life that when you get a sickness, He knows you won't quit? Will God still get the glory out of your life?
Come on.
Even if you die? Let me tell you. In John chapter 11, verse 4, it says, this sickness is not unto death, but, now here's what this sickness is for, but for the glory of God. Have you ever thought, because God's got enough of your heart, got enough of your life, that when you get a death sickness, that you still go, praise God, hallelujah. God, if it'll bring you glory, pour it on. He says, and then he says, that the Son of God might be glorified. Then he said this in verse 15. Jesus said, I am glad for your 12 apostles' sake. I was not there to the intent ye may believe. Uh-huh. Brother James, does God got enough of mine of your life that he can give us an evil disease that'll kill us, where your wife will have to bury you so that Jeff might believe, that we would sit back and say, Lord, pour it on as long as you get the glory.
Yeah.
Have we given him our heart enough, our life enough, that our kids could come down with a sickness that might take that out of this world, and it break us, it hurt us, we weep and we cry and we go to the altar and pray over it, but our last breath is, not my will, thine be done.
Yeah.
God, if you're going to take my kid, get the glory out of it. And that's what happened there. Lazarus did and was sick and did die. And Jesus did get his glory from his death. Jesus did get glorified. God got glorified. And the apostles did believe. But the problem is usually when we get sick and we think it's bad, we start complaining. And you know why that is? Because we really haven't given God our lives.
Right.
Paul in Acts chapter 16, Paul wanted to go to Asia. The Holy Spirit said no. Paul wanted to go to Bithynia. The Holy Spirit said no. Then the Holy Spirit gave him a vision to go to Macedonia. Oh, Lord, that's a little further than I wanted to go. I've got no money for a boat trip to get over there. Lord, why can't I just go to Asia? Why can't I just go to Bithynia? No, I want you to go to Macedonia. Okay, God, we'll go. And so he's got enough of your life that you get in the boat and you go. And you stay in the city of Philippi in Macedonia for a certain amount of days, and not one convert, not nothing, and nothing's happening. I mean, you get depressed, you get tore up. God, I passed up Asia, I passed up Bithynia.
them. I went to Macedonia. I'm in the city of Philippi, right where you told me to go, and nothing is happening. Why, God, did you send me over here? The Bible said that on the Sabbath that he went down to the river and there were certain women down there washing their clothes, and he started preaching and they started praying and one gets saved. One!
Yes.
One, only one. Lord, you sent me all the way over here. They spend tens and twenties and hundreds getting saved, and you sent me all the way to Philippi for one? For one, God. I don't understand it. He said, you still ain't in the right place yet. There's going to be more. Go back into Philippi. So he goes back into Philippi, and for now a number of days, he's out there preaching in the streets. He's holding up the Bible. He's presenting the gospel to everybody that passes by. And this one woman, a demon possessed, just kept yapping, 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 yapping behind him. And finally he said, turns around and says, come out of her. And the demon leaves. And then all of a sudden the town gets in an uproar because you cast out a demon, and they take you outside and they shackle you up and they beat you with stripes. God, why did you send me to this place? God, why are you doing this to me? Or do you just take it because it's God's life? It's God's body. I've been bought with a price. It belongs to him. And so you take it, and then they throw you into the inner prison, not just the outside, the inner. No windows, total darkness, and not on top of that, but they shackle your feet. And you're sitting there and not wondering. Finally, about midnight, the Bible says, Paul just starts singing Amazing Grace.
Yes.
How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Silas kicks in. And he starts singing, ain't God good to give us so many blessings? Undeserving, that's who we are. I just want to thank him. I just want to praise him. Boy, as they're singing, the jailhouse just shakes and rocks back and forth. And he gets to lead a jailer to the Lord.
Amen.
Then he gets to lead to the jailer's family back to the
Lord. Yes.
And he's going, Paul's going, oh, I didn't know this, Jesus. I didn't know this was your plan. I didn't know it, Lord. Thank you for letting me take the beatings that all these now I might be getting saved. Thank you for letting me go through what I go through. God, you're glorified. You're magnified. Does God have enough in your life that that had happened?
Yeah.
Lord, I'll accept your call to preach, but Lord, if it ain't sweet, I'm going to quit. If all the money's not there, I'll just quit. Then you got John the Baptist, the forerunner of Jesus Christ, baptizing people out there in the Jordan, and he wound up having his head beheaded for the Lord. And God got glorified, and Jesus got glorified. How about John started serving the Lord, laid his head on his bosom, and he wound up being boiled in oil and thrown on an Isle of Patmos to be killed. And God saw that and brought him up into heaven to where he could write the book of Revelation.
Yeah.
Stephen, a good deacon. He wasn't a preacher. He wasn't an apostle. He's just a deacon. And all of a sudden he started testifying. The whole town caught mad, stoned him to death. And can we, because of our life has been given to God so much that we stand back and we go, Lord, you're still wonderful. The Bible said he called upon God.
Yes.
He knelt down to the Lord. And then he asked God to forgive his enemies. And then he died because that was God's plan. So I want to wind up with this. Has God got enough of our life, 8:17? That he could tell us maybe something he wants us to do, like David at 15. That he tells us something he wants us to do, that we'll hang in there when all hell is raging in against us. Would we still serve God? Would you still serve God when nothing in the church is going right? When nothing and nobody likes you in the church, would you still hang in the church and say, Lord, do whatever to me you would have me to do. Whatever I need to go through, As long as you're getting the glory, as long as you're getting the benefit, Lord, it's yours anyway. You bought me with a price.
Right. Lord, I just want to please you. Let me ask you something. When's the last time you gave yourself to the Lord? You don't do that one time. And have you really, really given him your life that you would still hang in like these did? If you've never read any of them stories on that Fox's
Book of Martyrs,
you really need to read some.
Amen.
I got three books back there. I'll give you one if you want to read some. Where them people was being filleted and cut open, and as they're doing it, they keep singing about God.
Yeah.
As wives were watching their husband because they wouldn't denounce Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
They was cut up in little pieces. Little pieces. And they looked at the wife of that one man and they said, "What do you think about your husband now that he's in little pieces?" She was an Irish woman. She said, as she was picking up them body pieces, she said, "I thought of much of him when he was whole, and I think of more him now."
Yes. Amen.
Would you still serve God? While you're watching your two boys being arrowed because you wouldn't denounce Christ, that the chief had two of the soldiers shoot arrows at his two boys while they dropped dead there in the spot, and he wouldn't turn. And they said, "We're going to kill your wife right there if you don't denounce Christ." And he said, "Honey, we've gone too far. To turn back now, we're going to go on." And she said, "Yes, honey, we're going all the way." And he killed the wife right there in front of his two, right where the two boys died. And he turned to the kid chief, turned to him and said, "Now, if you don't denounce Christ, I'm fixing to put you in the same spot." And he says, "I will not turn back. I will not turn back." And they killed him there. And because of that, the chief, two or three nights, couldn't sleep. And he gets saved in that very spot. He bowed down and asked Christ to save him. Has God got your life like that?
Come on.
Has Christ got your life like that? Has Christ got my life like that? Would you please say it? Lord, search us tonight. Show us. Lord, if we don't think we have, help us to come down. Dedicate ourselves. Give us and say, "Here it is. Again, Lord, here it is again. Again." So much he did from his own son. Why shouldn't we get anything less? We already got better than we deserved.
Yes.
Is your all upon the altar of sacrifice? I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your body a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. Amen. I've read them tonight. Church, God wants more of you. More of you. When he's satisfied is when he's got every ounce of you. Every ounce of you. I pray that we all want that in our lives. Lord, tonight, I thank you, Jesus, for the church. I thank you, Lord, that you gave me all of you. Lord, help me in my weakness, in my lack of faith, my lack of belief. help my unbelief, Lord, to be able to give you more of me. Lord, that I'll forsake family. I'll forsake love. I'll forsake comfort. Lord, that you might have it all. Thank you, Jesus, for what you've done in our lives. You're worthy of all the praise, all the glory. Take us and use us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
See y'all.